Hello everyone, I hope you're having a great day. Welcome on in to the next video here going into the skeletal system. In this video, we're going to be going over bone markings. So bone markings are little markings on the bones. We're not only going to be knowing the radius, the ulna, we're going to be knowing all the different structures on those bones as well. And these markings are an important part to the bones because one, they help you name them. The markings are typically in the names of all these parts, and also it tells you the significance of what it does. Is it an opening or a groove? Is it an articulation spot? And so forth. So that's what we're going to be going over today, and that's what we mean by bone markings. So we're going to look at some of the bone markings and their functions, and hopefully I can provide a decent amount of examples for you. So this is just a long list, pretty much. Now this isn't conclusive. There are some other smaller markings outside of this, but this is what we're going to go through today. So the first marking we have, types of markings, are projections that are sites of muscle and ligament attachments. So this is where muscles and ligaments attach. So these markings are going to be a little bit more pronounced. They could be rough and so forth, or they could be just a line on a bone. All right, first one we have here is called a tuberosity. A tuberosity is a large rounded projection and may be roughened. Like I said, they could be rough. So here, a good example. So down here, I have images that I'm going to jump up, down, in between. So here is the humerus, a tuberosity here. This is called the deltoid tuberosity. It's a rough area on the humerus right here where the deltoid muscle comes down and inserts. Another example, so this is the hip bone. Look at all the stuff that's labeled on the hip bone. So you can see all of these bone markings coming up here, and we'll be talking about a bunch of them. Right here is the ischial tuberosity, a large rounded projection found on the hip bone. All right. Now, next one up here is a crest. Crest is a narrow ridge of bone, usually prominent. The big example of a crest that we have is found on the hip bone. We have the iliac crest found right here, which are the two wings coming out on the hip. Now, to jump forward here, we also have a line. A line is also a narrow ridge of bone, so some of these are subjective, but it is a little less prominent than a crest. Let's see, is there an example we found here? Yeah, here's the arcuate line. So there's this little line that comes up the hip bone here, and it's called the arcuate line. And there are some other lines that are found on some other bones here, like there's this supracondylar, medial and lateral supracondylar lines or ridges that come down the humerus right there as well. So we come across a few of those, not as common though. Next one here is called a trochanter. So a trochanter is a very large, blunt, or irregularly shaped process. And as it says here, this is only found on the femur. So there's only two of these. There's a greater and a lesser trochanter found on the femur, and it's not labeled on this image. But on the posterior side of this, there would be the greater trochanter, and then if this was turned around the other way, there'd be the lesser trochanter. So apologies for that. But so this is the posterior side right here. So there would be the greater trochanter. There would be the lesser trochanter found on the femur. So very large attachment sites for the muscles of the leg. Sorry for all the up and down scrolling in this video. Next up is a tubercle. So a couple T's here. So don't tuberosity, trochanter, and a tubercle. A tubercle, compared to a tuberosity, is large rounded. Tubercle is small rounded projection or process. Again, some things are subjective here. So there's a tubercle found up here on the head of the humerus. So there's a greater and lesser tubercle. So here's a greater tubercle, here's a lesser tubercle, then there's a little groove right here, and that's called the intertubercular sulcus. And that's actually your biceps brachii is right here, and the tendon for that, one of the tendons for that, runs right through that groove or that sulcus right there. And then we come across an epicondyle. So it's hard to define an epicondyle without first defining what a condyle is. So epi means upon. So these markings are upon condyles. So this is a raised area on or above a condyle. And just to jump ahead here, so surfaces that help form joints, a condyle is a rounded articular projection. And it typically is what's articulating or forming a joint with another bone. So a smooth rounded projection. So right above that, or above or below it, depending on how you're holding the bone, would be an epicondyle. So here on the femur, well, we could do this one right here on the humerus. This is the medial epicondyle. So right here are the condyles of the humerus. Now these ones get unique names for the elbow joint. But right here, your funny bone on the medial aspect, that little bump right there, that's called the medial epicondyle. And then there's also some epicondyles here found on the femur as well, both medial and lateral. I don't think there's any down there. And then we get a spine. A spine is a sharp, slender, often pointed projection. So we have a couple of these on the hip bone. Over here, we see the ischial spine. Here's the posterior inferior iliac spine. Then there's a posterior superior iliac spine. An anterior inferior iliac spine. As you can see, there's a lot of different ones. Don't worry about them all right now. But here, it's just a little pointed projection coming out. And then more of a bigger or generic projection is called a process. So there are a lot of processes we find. Each vertebra alone has 7 processes on it. Let's see, is there a process? I don't think there's a process on the hip, but if we go down here to just the entire skeletal system, every single vertebrae here, you see each of these are each called a transverse process. Those are 2 on each, and the one on the back is called the spinous process, the one that you can feel if you hit the back of your neck. So we come across a lot of processes when we come, especially the vertebrae, but we do on the skull, the inferior aspect of the skull. I can't see it on this image. You can kind of see them in here, but you have the styloid process and the mastoid process as well. And then we get some to other, so those are all where muscles and ligaments attach. And now the surfaces that help form joints. So we have a head. So here's the head of the humerus. That's obviously forming a joint. The head of the femur, I mean, is over here. The head of the humerus would be over here. And usually they're connected to a neck. So then theirs would be the neck. Now the humerus has a surgical and anatomical neck. So some slight differences there, but this would be the head of the femur, which then reaches out to then form that joint, to form the head then. And then a facet here is a smooth, flat articulating joint surface. So when two joints come together and form a flat connection, it's called a facet. So like where all the ribs come in and connect to the vertebrae. So down here, back to this. So all the ribs coming in back here form a little facet. The little flat articulations between all of the carpals in the wrist are all facets as well. So we'll come across a couple of those too as we go through. And then, so we talked about a condyle already, any rounded articular projection. So there's a lot of condyles, and they can be named medial or lateral. This would be medial, and this would be lateral here for the condyles. And some of the condyles can get unique names, like on the humerus, we have the capitulum and the trochlea, but there are technically condyles as well. They just have slightly different shapes to them. So that's all of those. And then moving forward here, now we get some depressions and openings. This is for things to move through, mostly arteries, veins, nerve, lymph vessels, and so forth. A groove is a furrow. Now I don't think there's any grooves on this image right here. The example of a groove I could think of is at the inferior side of every rib. There's a little groove that runs through it for the passageway of blood vessels. On the deep aspect of your mandible, your jawbone, there's a mandibular groove that runs back there as well. So sorry, no direct images for a groove here. And then a fissure is a narrow slit-like opening. So two common areas where we have a fissure. We have a supra and infraorbital fissure in the back of the eye. The other thing we find in the back of the eye is a canal. So a canal is also a hole. So sometimes you see a meatus as well. So there's an external acoustic meatus, which is your ear canal. The optic canal is the pathway for the optic nerve. So that's a canal. And then a very, very common one here, especially. There are 85 named openings in the skull alone. Thankfully, most of them are pairs. Is a foramen. A foramen is a round or oval opening through a bone. If you pluralize foramen, it's foramina, if you ever see that term. So here, you know, just a couple spots. There's the supraorbital foramen. There is an infraorbital foramen down, it's right there, down here as well. Over here is the mental foramen. So this is the mental region. There's another projection here. It's called a protuberance as well for your chin too, but don't really talk about that one too much. But so a foramen is a hole. The hole in the base of the skull is the foramen magnum, where your spinal cord exits and, or connects to the brainstem then. And then we have a notch. So it's any indentation. So like mandibular notch. You can't really see it on this, but there is a little notch in the mandible over there. Another example of the notch, we can go up here. There's the greater sciatic notch. So it's a little indent. Down here would be the lesser sciatic notch. Here's another example of a foramen. The hole could be pretty large too. This is called the obturator foramen. So again, you don't have to know all these markings I'm saying right now, but if you're getting any indication of the importance of knowing these markings, it really helps you how to find where something is on a bone or get a good idea. If I tell you to ask to look for a foramen, you know you're looking for a hole. So you can see how that helps and can be important. And then a sinus here. Sinus is an internal cavity in a bone. So it's lined with mucous membranes. And so these are all in the skull. So like the frontal nasal sinuses here, you got the ethmoidal sinuses, maxillary sinuses, and then there are sphenoidal sinuses back there. And these help humidify air. They also help lighten your skull. If you ever had a sinus infection, you know how heavy your skull feels. And so those are just open areas inside these bones. And then we have a fossa, or fossae for plural, this shallow basin-like deep basin-like depression in a bone, serving as an articular surface sometimes. Up here, there's the, so this is the ilium region, and then this is the iliac fossa. There's a smooth, well, it would be on this side over here, sorry, iliac fossa here on the inside of the hip. And then here's the auricular surface, which is where the hip bones articulate with each other. So here it's flipped over. So the iliac fossa is on that side there. So if we look down here, we're referring to this region right there where the iliac fossa is. And then so if we look at the the scapula here. So this is the scapular spine. So a spine, that projection coming out. And then we have the supraspinous fossa, the infraspinous fossa. And then over here on the deep aspect of the scapula is the subscapular fossa. So there, fossa just came back in all those terms, and it helps remember all of them. Below the kneecap is the patellar fossa. So it's a smooth articulating surface. And that's most of the major markings. Just note that there are some others. So like down here, there's the lateral and then the medial malleolus. Lateral malleolus is found on the fibula. Medial malleolus is found on the tibia. And these ones are the little bumps you feel on your ankles. And a malleolus is, you know, like a mallet. And so there are a few other ones we might come across when going through the bones coming up in the skeletal system, but I just wanted to introduce these markings here so we have a good idea of their importance and their function. So forming joints, having, you know, holes for things to move through, things being arteries, veins, so your blood vessels, nerves, lymphatic system, and then also the big projections are the ones for sites of muscle and ligament attachment. So I hope you enjoyed that overview of bone markings. If you have any questions, like always, let me know and see you in the next one. Bye-bye.